Hello everyone, welcome back to GK Code Labs. So in this session we'll be discussing about Spark with GCS connectivity or Spark with Google Cloud Storage connectivity. So as we all know, the Google Cloud Storage is the managed storage provided by the Google Cloud Platform. And when it comes to a Spark application, most of the big data projects prefer to keep their data on a managed cloud file system, one of which is Google Cloud Storage. And when it comes to establishing a connection between Apache Spark application to any external storage, there are few points and few configurations that are to be taken care of so that Spark could understand and interact with the specific storage system. So I'll be taking this session step by step so that it's easy for you to remember and that you get all the important steps that are to be taken care of while doing this. So let's see an overview of what we'll be discussing in this video. First is the code structure. As right now we are connecting our Spark application with Google Cloud Storage, but it's not necessary that we'll be always connecting it with Google Cloud Storage. For this use case, yes, but still we'll see a basic code structure that I have made so that our code is more manageable, more lucid. We'll try to take a config-driven approach so that our application is scalable in case we have multiple file systems in the future. After discussing the code structure, we'll see Spark application settings, the important ones like project dependencies, what we need in order to connect our application with GCS, Spark configurations, Hadoop specific configuration, and how we can authenticate our Google Cloud Storage from our Spark application. And then also, as we are connecting to Google Cloud Storage, we'll also see bucket creation, creation of service accounts, key management, and obviously termination. We don't want to keep getting charged just for this demo, right? So in these three basic sections, I believe you'll be able to write a very manageable code and interact with your Google Cloud Storage. So let's jump right into our application and get started. Okay, so this is our basic code structure, and if you follow my videos you might have already seen this, where we were asked to get the latest directories from the partition. If you have not seen that video, I'll link that in I button. You can go see. The basic code structure is same, but anyways I'll explain it. So I have created a base job which actually has a main method, and we are reading two input arguments, and based on which we are reading our configuration, that is jobconfigs.conf. Don't worry, I'll push this to GitHub repository, so all the extended plan members who have access to the Git repo can pull this branch and go through the code. But for everyone, based on these two configs, we are reading what configuration file has to be read will be our first argument, and in that config file which particular environment we are reading, that is argument 2. So if you see, while running we'll be passing something like this jobconfigs.conf and local, the name of this. So that is how I have made this structure, so that in future in case any more type of storage comes in, we just have to add one config, and respective to that we can set the Spark and Hadoop options. We don't have to go inside our code and change anything. So what happens, there is a base job which actually has a main method and which sets the properties and loads all this configuration from job config. I have already explained the working of it in the same video. You'll also find the link in description. And then based upon those properties, it makes a Spark session. And to make this Spark session usable, I have created a method inside it, execute job, which any class which is extending the base job can override and use the Spark session in the application. So this is nothing but every job that extends base job needs to override this method. So segregating like this makes the application more lucid and more scalable. We'll see how. Right now my task is to connect our application with GCS. So I have created a GCS connection handler. Now this does nothing but it extends the base job. So now we can override execute base job, and inside this we will have everything that was being created inside the main job. Okay, so now let's come to the point. I have written a very basic code where we'll have some read path, some write path, and a very simple input df where we'll read data from storage. This is a very boilerplate code for this use case. It's very apparent, just a normal infer schema, header true, delimiter. I have taken this for the reason I'll show you a sample data set which I'll be taking for this. So this is that sample data. I have just downloaded some random data from Kaggle. So this is delimited by semicolon, some smartphone data it seems. So just delimiter is this and CSV read path, and just a normal show just to see if we are able to read or write. Okay, now everyone is aware that if I give directly this path as a read path, let me comment the right one for now, and if I run it, we'll be able to read it just like we have always seen, because while running I am passing the config and from that local. Okay, and local is nothing but our file system. Now what if we have to create something like, if I give any GCS related path here, still it should be able to read if we put the same file in the GCS location. Now code structure is almost done. We have seen how we are making it config driven and how it can be scalable. We'll see once we implement GCS connection. Now coming to Spark application project dependencies. So first we have to add some dependency that should be able to give us libraries which can communicate with Google Cloud Storage. So a library which I have added here is com.googlecloud big data OSS GCS connector and Hadoop 3-2.0.o. So this work, although there are many other versions available, and 2-7 or something like that also worked but was giving me some issues. So this I found was working perfectly, and this may change depending upon what time you are watching this video. But the specific cloud big data library you have to add. So in your build.sbt you can add this, you can pause the video, add this, or it is also easily available in Maven repository. Just search with Google Cloud Storage dependency for Scala, you'll get the same. Just paste it here, import your SBT dependency, and your library will be imported. Make a note of this, I'm using 2.11.12 as a Scala version and 2.3.2 as the Spark version. So for that, I find this version working perfectly fine. The same also worked for Spark 2.4.5. So just check the compatibility. This set worked for me fine. Okay. Now Spark configs and Hadoop configs. These are two very important configuration when you are configuring your Spark application to interact with any external storage. So same with the project structure, we'll go in the same way. What I'll do, similar to our local, I'll create another config, because as you know, we have configured our main job that is here that will accept this, and with the JSON properties loader which also we have created, I have explained already, with the config factory we are parsing the properties and setting up while creating our Spark session. So you can see all the Spark option and Hadoop option we are already setting into Spark context Hadoop configuration, and while creating Spark conf all the options. Let's name it GCS or dev environment for GCS. Now what goes different for this? First of all, the Hadoop options, this is the basic configuration that you need to set, which if set in Hadoop configuration, that is your spark.sparkcontext.hadoop configuration, if this property fs.defaultfs is set, then your Spark application will consider that as your default file system, which in our case for DevGCS is going to be GS followed by Google Cloud Storage works on the concepts of buckets. So whatever bucket can be a container for holding your object. GCS is an object storage. So this can be a container which holds those objects. So in case of GCS, this can be your, this particular thing will be your default FS. Bucket we'll come to know once we'll create one. Similarly, if you are going with Azure, this can be something like ADLS or ABFSS, whatever type of Azure storage you are using. In case of Amazon S3, this would be S3, then the bucket name. So that is what the base file system. You have to make sure your Spark application understand that this will be your base file system, and you can set it in Hadoop configuration. This is just a section of configuration which I'm searching here, that whatever is in Hadoop option, I have to set it in Hadoop configuration. As you see here, I'm taking the Hadoop options and setting it in Spark Hadoop configuration. Now coming back to the point, now coming for Spark option, which actually will be set up in configurations of your Spark session once you create a Spark session. So just make a note that there are basically two configs. First, once you create the bucket, do you require an authentication or you don't? So a true or false on that, we'll see what actual explanation of that is. So as of now, just see auth is either true or false. We'll come back to this and edit this once we create our bucket. Just make a note of things as we are going. And then if the authentication is true, how to authenticate? So there is specifically a key file or a certificate that we'll see how we can get it issued and how we can use it in our application. So a key, some key. So just these three simple things should make this work. Now, before elaborating these two, auth and key, let me create a bucket first in GCS, and then these two things will make more sense to you. Okay. So project dependencies, Spark, Hadoop, configs, everything is done. Authentication we'll see after creating our bucket. Now coming to Google Cloud Storage bucket creation. Now let me go to my GCP account. If you don't have one, you can create it. It's absolutely free. Also for 90 days, you'll get a credit of $300, which can be used within certain limits. So let me tell you, the services like Google Cloud Storage are not free, but anyways, for 90 days, you are getting a credit of $300, which as of this date comes with somewhere around 21,776 odd Indian rupees. So it's pretty much enough for you to get your hands on. Back to topic, creating a bucket. So first of all, on the left, scroll down through all the services and see inside storage, you'll see cloud storage. Click on this. Okay, right now I don't have any bucket. Let me create one. First, let's give it a name. Let me give GK Code Labs demo bucket. Okay, continue. Now location type, multi-region, dual region, region. Very clear with their name itself. Right now for demo, I just need it for single region. This is a certain high availability because nodes will be distributed up across two regions, and a multi-region will be distributed across multiple regions. Now location, you can choose anything. Always prefer to choose any location which is close to your geographical location, although we this just for demo, I'll select Asia South Mumbai because I'm in India. Continue. Now there are different type of storage as well: standard, nearline, cloudline, and archive. And a short description is written right below them. Archive is used for some data which you are not planning to access or just used for preservation, cold line just for disaster recovery. Mostly you can see the time associated with it, which Google prefers, and for same reason it has Google has bifurcated these into different versions. So if you have the data which you are planning to access, let's say once a quarter, you can choose cold line, near line if you are accessing your data, let's say once a month, standard which you are accessing very frequently. So more on this is already available in Google papers for GCP. If you are interested, you can go read about them. I'll choose standard, do continue. Now access controlled, again uniform is fine. It is just for identity access management. So how precisely you want to give the access, different options for that. I'll let it be uniform, continue. Now coming to encryption, this is important that we have to consider for this tutorial as well. So there could be two type of encryptions: Google managed encryption key and customer managed encryption key. So if you are a big firm and you don't want to use any Google managed key, or you already have some managed key for your data or a pool of data or anything pertaining to your domain, you can use, Google allows you, but there is always a managed key service as well from Google. So I'll let this be checked. Retention policy, I believe you know what this means. Maximum duration for the buckets object that can be protected it for. I don't want it. I'll just do create. Okay, so you can see inside buckets, my GK Code Labs demo bucket is created. Now here, I have the liberty to create folder, upload files, create folder, upload folder as well. Oh, just like anything, input, you can create. Let me create output. So I already have input and output. Okay, you can just go here, delete, and whatever you want. Now our bucket creation is done. Hope you got it and what options you have to select, just keep in mind. Now coming to service accounts, what are these, why we need them? You see, if you go inside the configuration of this bucket, you'll see how to access it. It's given GS util URI. So that is GS then slash the bucket name, as I told you in the application, right? It has to be GS then the bucket name. That is how Google Cloud Storage can take the request and access your objects. But this is a GS util URI. GS util is the inbuilt client that can be used to access as a command line from the console, or if you install GS util client on your machine, you can access this from there as well. Just it's something similar to HDFS command, like you do HDFS fs-ls or HDFS DFS ls, then you list it, copy. So something like that, because this is not HDFS, this is GS util. So there are multiple commands, but the challenge for us is we don't have to run command line. We have to make it accessible from our Spark application. So this is fine. Let me copy it, copy, and okay, fine. I have got my default FS, but I have to use it in the application. So something I have to do, that my application can authenticate that if I have created this. How can it allow this application also to access the same? So for that reason, the service accounts come into play. We have to create a service account. Now service account can come under your IAM admin, and inside that you can see service accounts. Okay, service account can be created inside your project. There will be one default project. Also, if you want, you can, as per the scale of your project, you can create multiple projects inside which you can manage your environments. This is the default one, it's fine. I'll create a service account. Let us name it GK bucket account. Okay, And service account description, anything you can give as per you, bucket access. Okay, now click on create. We'll see how to use it. Then grant this service account access to the project. So how and all this service account will be able to use our project resources. So different roles are there. So anything, let's go in basic, let's make it owner itself. So owner, you can see full access to all resources. Okay, so it's owner. Continue. On the right side, you can see role, member, expand the owner. One is my email ID, obviously, because I have created this, and one is the service account, which will be a separate entity, which I can authenticate from my application. And grant access to this service account, you can ignore this. Just click on done. Now you can see the service account is created, status is active, name and everything. Okay, now next part is key management. Just make sure all these steps you have to follow. Only I believe these two things are a bit critical, otherwise the bucket also not critical, it's just do the next. Only few things like giving what role, service account creation, creating keys will take little of your attention. Otherwise the bucket creation, as you saw, is very simple. Now for this service account, what you have to do, go on actions and manage keys. Okay, right now you can see there is no key. Click on add key and create new key. There are two options, JSON or P12. So any format is fine. I have tested both with the Spark application and both work just fine, so no issues. I'll just let it be JSON. So click on create. Okay, close. And there you see right away we got a JSON key file. Let's open it. So this is our key file. What I'll do, I'll directly copy it and keep it in my project itself. Let's keep it in resources. Okay, no, I don't want to add it in Git. I'll not be pushing this file because anyways this is of no use to you. This is created from my account. But let's see sort of content in this. Type service account, client email ID. Make sure this is not my email, this is the email of the service account which I created. Okay, authentication URI, and finally all this, and your all this private key for the certificate. Okay, so this is the format that we got. Now let's see how to use it. First of all, we got the file, so let's copy the path. Let's copy from content root and use it where in the job config. The key, we got it here. Okay, now the thing you have to notice, auth will obviously be true because we are using key file. The specific configuration that Spark option needs for it to understand that this is the Google key, not some file, not some just a normal JSON file. So those configurations, just make a note, it will be spark.hadoop.google. This is anyways available in Google documentation also, but you don't need to go through all of it. You are already watching this video, so I'm giving you direct what configuration you have to use. Google Cloud Auth Service Account dot JSON dot key file. This is the config. Like this is how you have to mention your key file so that it understands that this is the Hadoop Cloud Google file which is to be understood by Spark, and this is the actual authentication key file for it. Okay, and similarly for the auth as well, till here it is same account, and in place of auth you have to do dot enable. Okay, so this is how you have to mention your auth enable and your key file. I hope it is clear till now. Now one thing to make sure, how Spark will behave after having this default FS set. Let's go back to our main job and also place our data file. Where is it? Our data file is in this. So let me go back to my bucket, storage bucket. that's cloud storage, my bucket. Input and output is already there. Let's make a new folder, GCS test input, and upload the file. And the same file, I'll upload it here. Okay, uploading is done. And for the output also, anyways, let it be. We already have the output folder. So from our input, this is the data, right? So here is how you can copy. Just click on this option. It will copy. And read path, give it right here. Now the thing to note here that our base file system, close all other things, the base file system, default file system is already till your bucket name. So you need not mention here directly, your input path should suffice. Okay, and similarly the write path, or just let's see if we are able to read it. And the thing is, in my config, now I won't be using local, I have to use GCS. Otherwise, it will still be reading from my local. Let me delete it from my local. Input, I'll delete it. Okay, so let's change our config. I'll make it dev GCS. Apply, okay. Dev GCS. Let's run it. Okay. So we are successfully able to read it. And you can see we are doing a file scan, reading file path from GCS bucket. Let's also see if we are able to write it as well. Write path, we have it. Inside output, I'll create in run one. Also guys, I mean, this input path also, I won't suggest that input or output path, I won't suggest that you keep it inside your code. Just make another config file from where you should read it, just the same way we are reading all this. That is the better practice. And let me uncomment this now. Okay, so the same thing that it will read, we are writing just to test if it is able to write. So reading is done, now it is doing a write. Okay, so you see here, attempt save output task to GS output run, and this is, let's see our bucket, refresh it, and you see there is run one, and we have our files. And in future, if there are more file systems you have to configure, this you need to replicate this, or you can also create different packages, different folders where you can maintain your different environments. Okay, only thing, you have to see what specific Spark Hadoop configs you have to set for the storage in question. Okay, so I believe you have got this as well, and whatever we left, authentication part is also covered. And scalable part, I just told, same way you can make your operations config driven. Okay, now most important part, termination. Because although we are getting $300, but don't forget to terminate your resources, otherwise all this $300 will run out very soon. Okay, so first of all, you have to go to buckets. Select the bucket, delete it. While deleting, just to be sure, it asks you to type delete, but we anyways copy paste, delete. Now going back to your service accounts. This as well is not required now. So delete. Okay, so all this is done, and with that we are done. So I hope you got how we can connect our Spark with the GCS. Any other question, let me know in the comment section below. Thank you guys for watching this, and stay tuned to GK Code Labs.